حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله.
Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to him. He born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them.
Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to him. He born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. Rasul Allah.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأولين والآخرين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear viewers, welcome back to another live edition of Gardens of the Pious. Today's episode is number 553 and we continue with the 15th book of Riyadh al-Salihin by Imam Nawawi, the book of the remembrance of Allah, and the chapter number 244, the virtues and the excellence of the remembrance of Allah and encouraging doing so. Today will be the 12th session in the chapter, inshallah. Without any further ado, hadith number 1430, عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت افتقدت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات ليلة فتحسست فإذا هو راكع أو ساجد يقول سبحانك وبحمدك لا إله إلا أنت، وفي رواية فوقعت يدي على بطن قدميه وهو في المسجد وهما منصوبتان وهو يقول اللهم إني أعوذ برضاك من سخطك وبمعافاتك من عقوبتك وأعوذ بك منك لا أحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. We have a sound hadith collected by Imam Muslim, may Allah have mercy on him. He narrated that the mother of the believers, Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, said one night, which was one of her nights, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was scheduled to spend the night in her chamber, in her room. So one night I missed Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from his bed. So I searched for him, and the word tahassastu, I started touching with my hands here and there in order to find out where is he at, because they didn't have light at night. So I searched for him, and when I found him, he was in either ruku' or prostrating himself in sujood position. And what matters, I heard them reciting, you are free from any imperfection. Subhanaka wa bihamdika, and I praise you for guiding me to recognize your oneness and to recognize that you are indeed free from any imperfection. Very comprehensive form of dhikr. Subhanallah wa bihamdi, subhanallah al-azim. We'll shed some light on its meaning after we finish the general meaning of the hadith. In another narration, Aisha radiyallahu anha said, so my hand fell over his feet while he was in the sujood position. He was prostrating himself with his feet up so that the toes were on the ground and the heels were up. So his feet was erect while in sujood, and he was supplicating, O Allah, inni a'udhu bi ridaka min sakhatik, I seek refuge and protection in your pleasure against your wrath. I seek refuge and protection in your pardon against your punishment. And I'm not capable of counting and enumerating praise of you. Indeed, you are as you praised yourself. Allahumma inni a'udhu bi ridaka min sakhatik wa bi mu'afatika min uqubatik. وأعوذ بك منك, and I seek refuge in you against you. I do not enumerate praises of you. أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. Indeed, you are exactly as you have praised yourself. No one would ever praise you better than what you praise yourself with. Well, now let's look at a couple of facts. When Aisha رضي الله عنها said, فوقعت يدي على بطن قدميه وهو في المسجد وهما منصوبتان. So that gives us a description. What should be the posture of sujood and how it should be, and the feet, men and women. Because those who come late, if I come late to the masjid and I see people prostrating themselves, you see a lot of varieties. Some people's one foot on top of the other, and this is wrong. And how bad is it? Is it just dislike? No, that invalidates the prayer. Those who put one foot on top of the other, that would invalidate the prayer. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like you see the X sign, the wrong style, that's not just wrong because this is just, not the right posture and the prayer is valid. No, that invalidates the whole prayer. Oh my God, my son or my daughter or my spouse have been doing this forever. And I never thought it would invalidate the prayer. Well, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أمرت أن أسجد على سبعة أعظم. Okay? So I was commanded to prostrate myself while putting seven body parts, seven bones on the ground. So the two hands, the two knees, the toes of the two feet, and the jabha along with the nose, the forehead along with the nose. These are seven body parts, or as he said, seven bones. Those who do this in sujood, it's invalid. Those who put one hand and the other, they do not place it on the ground, is not valid. Those who do not prostrate themselves completely on the ground, they risk and jeopardize the validity of their sujood, such as by putting either the forehead alone or the nose alone. You see people doing so. It must be both. Those who lift one foot and they place it on top of the other, as we have seen in the wrong image, that invalidates the sujood. There are others who do it differently, but the prayer is valid. It's a different hay'ah, different form. By we said Aisha radiallahu anha said, فَوَقَعَتْ يَدِي عَلَى بَطْنِ قَدَمَيْهِ وَهُمَا مَنْصُوبَتَانِ. So imagine these are the toes. They are on the floor. This is a wrong posture. This is a wrong position of placing the feet in the prayer. Whether in the sitting for tashahud or the between the two sajdas. I mean, when I say wrong, that doesn't invalidate the prayer though. But some people cannot do any better. This is the proper way as the hadith described it. You put the two feet up, you rest against the toes, heels up, so the two feet are erected. This is the right position and according to the sunnah. So this is as far as one thing that we learn in the prayer, how we offer the prayer and how we make sujood. Also, the beautiful dhikr, سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك لا إله إلا أنت. We know that the best of dhikr ever is التهليل or declaring the oneness of Allah. The kalima لا إله إلا الله. But before that, he begins with the praises, the words of the praises. سبحانك التسبيح سبح لله ما في السماوات وما في الأرض سبح اسم ربك الأعلى. Etc. to the rest of the commands of Allah of doing tasbih. Yani, to declare that the Almighty Allah, the Lord, our Creator, is free from any imperfection. He is unlike any of the creation and is free from any imperfection. Great. You've been rightly guided to that and you have been distinct from those who drew images, statues, or carry images of gods in their necklace, in their pockets, in their wallets, and they, whenever they need to pray, they take it out and they pray to the image, or they go to places of worships where they have statues and images of God. So you have been rightly guided to recognize all of that is false. ما هذه الأصنام التي أنتم لها عاكفون, as Abraham said to his people, what are those statues which you bow down and prostrate yourselves before? Can they hear you when you talk to them, when you call upon them? Can they benefit you or protect you against any harm? No, then they're not gods. فإنهم عدو لي إلا رب العالمين الذي خلقني فهو يهدين والذي يميتني ثم يحيين. So all of them are fake. The only Lord is the one who gives me life and guidance. The one who will cause me to die, then he will bring me back to life. The one who feeds me and gives me the drink. The one whom I hope and I pray that he will forgive me my sins and pardon me on the day of resurrection. يوم الدين, the day of accountability and reckoning. Good, beautiful. So how many people worldwide nowadays will take our era as an example? How many people recognize that? Minority. Few. So you're one of the minority. وَقَلِيلٌ مِّنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ. And Allah praises this minority. And you've been rightly guided by Allah. So that's why you say, Alhamdulillah, all praises be to you. Thank you for guiding me to this fact. So that's why saying Subhanallah wa bihamdi works out perfect and in a great harmony. Indeed, you are free from any imperfection. And I begin by praising you for guiding me for that. الَّذِي خَلَقَنِي فَهُوَ يَهْدِينَ. So guidance is from the Almighty Allah. Now, then, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. None has the right to be worshipped but you. She also said that she heard him saying, O Allah, I seek refuge with you against. Against what? Against many things which also come from him. And this is an amazing interpretation of the beautiful command, divine command of Surah Al-Zariyat, in which the Almighty Allah says, excuse me, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنِّي لَكُمْ مِنْهُ نَذِيرٌ مُبِينٌ. فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. This ayah is an amazing ayah. Ayah number 50, chapter number 51, Surah Al-Zariyat. Al-Firar is to flee from, to run off, to escape. To escape from whom? From Allah. To what and to whom? To take shelter in whom? In Allah. The only one whom, whenever we run away from, we run away unto Him. And we take shelter with Him. Against what? Against His anger, against His chastisement, His punishment, His torment, His azab, etc. فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. So that's why the dua is simply an interpretation of that. I say, اللَّهُمَّ إِنِّي أَعُوذُ بِرِضَاكَ مِنْ سَخَطِكَ. السَّخَط means the wrath, the anger. So Allah, I seek refuge in you and with you. Against what? From what? From your wrath and against your anger. وَبِمُعَافَاتِكَ مِنْ عُقُوبَتِكَ. اعلموا أن الله شديد العقاب. Know that Allah indeed is severe in torment. وأنه غفور رحيم. And He's indeed غفور, of forgiven, رحيم, most merciful. So a combination of both. He possesses both. But He said, رحمتي سبقت غضبي. Indeed, my mercy surpassed my anger and my wrath. So I seek refuge in your mercy, in your pleasure, against your wrath and against your anger. وَبِمُعَافَاتِكَ مِنْ عُقُوبَتِكَ. And I seek refuge in your pardon, against your punishment. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْكَ. And this is a literal interpretation of فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. And I seek refuge with you, against you. With your mercy, with your pardon, with your rizq, with your pleasure, against your wrath, against your punishment, against your displeasure. لا أحصي ثناء عليك. I wish I can praise you enough, but there is no way that I can praise you enough. قل لو كان البحر مدادا لكلمات ربي لنفد البحر قبل أن تنفد كلمات ربي وَلَوْ جِئْنَا بِمِثْلِهِ مَدَدًا. Allah deserves all the words of praises. So if all the trees, وَلَوْ أَنَّمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ شَجَرَةٍ أَقْلَامٌ, I love to sharpen pins out of the bamboo and out of the trees, the wood, and dip them in the ink and write with them. So if all the trees on earth were made into pens, ink pens, and sharpened, أَقْلَام, plural of قَلَم, مِنْ شَجَرَةٍ أَقْلَام, وَالْبَحْرُ, and all the seas and the waters, which are more than two-thirds of the whole world, turn into ink. So we use all the trees and the pens which we take out of the trees, and the water turned into ink in order to write the words of the praises and the blessings of the Almighty Allah, even if the water is supplied with seven times more the size of the water of the earth, it won't be enough. مَا نَفِدَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ. If this is the case, then I better say لَا أُحْصِي ثَنَاءً عَلَيْكَ, I cannot praise you enough. I cannot enumerate the words of praise. You're above all of that. So I'm a simple, humble servant of yours. I do my best. That's why in a couple of hadith to come, we'll study a very comprehensive da'wah. Say, I praise you as much as it pleases you. What can I do? I can never praise you enough. I cannot praise you enough for what you deserve. I cannot praise you enough for your blessings, for your countless blessings which you bestowed upon me. Remember the story of the guy who have worshipped Allah for so many years. In one narration it says 600 years. Because people in the past used to live for hundreds of years. And the servant of Allah lived on top of a mountain. Allah grew some trees, provided him with the fruits. So he didn't have to work. He didn't have to worry about going to the marketplace. And he lived all his life in worship. So when he died, the Almighty Allah said to the angels, now take my servant's soul to paradise by my mercy. But the servant had another opinion. He said, why by your mercy, O Allah? I thought I have worshipped you enough and I deserve that. Shouldn't it be by my deeds, by my good deeds, due to my heavy scale of the good deeds, because of my salihat which I've done? So the Almighty Allah says, nay, but by my mercy. And Allah the Almighty showed him that all his deeds, all his words of praises were not enough to give thanks for one ni'mah. He said, why don't you weigh the 600 years of his worship versus one of my blessings which I bestowed upon him, the ni'mah of the sight, the blessing of being able to see. So that sight blessing was put in one pot and it outweighed all the worship of the hundreds of years. So he said, my servant, you didn't give enough thanks for a single blessing which I bestowed upon you. Do you still deserve to enter my paradise by your good deeds? He said, rather by your mercy, O Allah. And that's why it is very befitting to say, لا أحصي ثناء عليك. لا أحصي ثناء. I can never praise you enough. I'm not capable of enumerating praises of you. Subhanallah. It is best to say, أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. You are as you have praised yourself. The following hadith. Hadith number 1431. Another sound hadith narrated by the Prophet's uncle, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, radiyallahu anhu, qal, kunna inda Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, faqal, aya'jizu ahadukum an yaksiba fi kulli yawmin alfa hasana? Fasa'alahu sa'ilun min julasa'ih, kafa yaksibu alfa hasana? Qala yusabbihu mi'ata tasbiha, fayuktabu lahu alfu hasana. أو يحط عنه ألف خطيئة. رواه مسلم. One of the beautiful deeds, which was simple, with a huge volume of reward and compensation. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم presented his advice in the form of a rhetoric question in order to make the audience more attentive when he says, would it be too much for any of you to earn 1,000 good deeds every day for simple deeds? So one of the audience said, Ya Rasulullah, how can one earn 1,000 good deeds every day? He said, by making tasbih, saying subhanallah 100 times, you get 1,000 good deeds. Or Allah will remove thereof 1,000 of your sins. Subhanallah. Very simple. Like when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Ali radiyallahu anhu, oh Ali, would it be too much for you to recite the whole Quran every single night? He said, the whole Quran? How can one recite the whole Quran every single night? Would it be too much for you to recite 1/3 of the Quran every single night? How? He said, recite Surah Al-Ikhlas. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ وَلَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. It is equivalent to 1/3 of the Quran. So if I recite it, I get a reward equivalent to the reward of reciting 1/3 of the Quran. Yes, because its meaning represents 1/3 of the message that Allah has delivered in the Quran. Some beginners may say, that's too much. Well, because you don't know whom you're dealing with. You're used to a materialistic transaction where you want to buy this item. If you can afford it, you pay for it. If you can, perhaps you wait until it is off season or whenever it is put on sale. If there is any item left or the item on display, so they give it 45%, 50%, 60% off. This is how we deal with each other. How we deal with each other? 1 plus 1 equals 2. 2 plus 3 equals 5. But how we deal with Allah the Almighty is like that. مَنْ جَاءَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ فَلَهُ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا. Whosoever brings a single good deed, the Almighty Allah will reward him for it. The minimum and the least reward is 10 times thereof. So you give 1 pound, it is similar to giving 10 pounds as far as rewards. And yes, by the way, you know, brothers and sisters, it just popped up in my mind right now. You know, you have heard about the huge blast and explosions that happened in one of the ports in Beirut, which destroyed hundreds of thousands of homes. Actually, over 200,000 homes were destroyed and affected. Thousands of people were injured and hundreds of people were killed. May Allah have mercy on all of them, and may Allah alleviate their pain and sorrow and remove their suffering. But besides dua, I just received a call from the UK. Again, the Human Appeal will be launching a campaign in order to deliver an immediate assistance in the form of food and food supplies and even cash medical supplies in affiliation with the Red Crescent. Yes, with the Red Crescent. This is what I was told. So immediately I said, yes, I would like to participate. So inshallah, it will be launched today. I know we just finished, alhamdulillah, digging water wells in Pakistan and Bangladesh and in Gaza here and there. The goodness is plenty of doors. As much as you can invest. Alhamdulillah, we are participating, we're not beneficiary. So we're not taking a penny out of, I'm not taking a penny out of that. Okay? Rather, we are assisting, alhamdulillah, shukla. So if you find in yourself any capacity, by any means, to contribute towards alleviating the pain and removing the suffering of Muslims anywhere, do not hesitate to do that. And by the way, in this case, it may be Muslims or non-Muslims. People are affected and they need immediate help. So the ayah which I was just referring to of Surah Al-An'am, even though you get 10 times at least reward for any good deed, but when it comes to the bad deed, one single bad deed for the bad deed you did. And if you say astaghfirullah and you repent, it will be wiped out. Not only that, فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ. You can even turn the bad deeds into good deeds when you repent sincerely and you follow the bad deeds. إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَامِلَ عملا صالحا. سورة الفرقان. So if one repents, believes and does good deeds, فأولئك يبدل الله سيئاتهم حسنات. Such people Allah will turn the count of their sins into the same count but of good deeds. That is because Allah is ever oft forgiven, most merciful. Hey brothers and sisters, let's take a short break and we'll be back inshallah with another beautiful hadith in this magnificent book of the remembrance of Allah. Please stay tuned.
رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back. By now our phone numbers would appear on the bottom of the screen, area code 002, then 02385131, then area code 002-0100-546-9323, WhatsApp numbers area code 001-347-806-0025, and finally area code 001-361-489-1503. Sister Zinat from the USA, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you, Dr. Muhammad?
I'm doing fine, Sister Zinat. Thank you. And you?
Thank you. Yeah. Okay, I have a question. Every time I'm thinking from the day of the Arfa, if you can little explain me. My question is why every year Ghilaf-e Kaaba is changing? And did Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam ever change Ghilaf-e Kaaba or four caliph? That's my question.
Okay, Sister Zinat. Yes, the Kaaba has been covered with a cloth, very fine fabric, even before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was commissioned with the prophethood. But it was not necessarily exchanged every year. They couldn't afford it. The Kaaba was huge. And one day when a woman was lighting incense to purify the building and make it smell good, the cloth caught fire and it was burned. So they made a new one. Nowadays, normally they change the cloth of the Kaaba or the garment of the Kaaba, if you may like to call it this way, the Kiswa, on the day on which people go to Arafah, because the Haram will be almost empty. So it would not be as crowded. Will people, the workers, the employees, can it change it with peace? But is it required? It is not required. It is one of the signs of, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. It is a way of honoring the house of Allah, the symbol of Islam, the Qibla of the Muslims. Assalamu alaikum.
Okay, how are you?
Alhamdulillah, Umm Sana. Go ahead.
Sheikh, two questions.
Yeah.
One is, Sheikh, when we are memorizing the Quran and a sujood comes, so do I make the same line as I am repeating to memorize? Do I repeat sujood or I make one sujood?
Umm Sana,
sujood al-tilawa.
I would appreciate, number one, if you can hear me, to rephrase your question. It's not really clear to me.
Hello? Yes, I'm not able to hear you, sorry.
Well, I didn't get your question. You're asking about which sujood, Umm Sana?
Sujood al-tilawa, Sheikh, sujood al-tilawa.
Okay.
When we memorize Quran.
Yes. I got your
there
question.
There is a sujood. Yeah. And there is a line with sujood.
No, you don't have to repeat the sujood. If you recite the same ayah so many times in the same halqa, in the same sitting, because you're memorizing or revising, you only make one sujood. And you don't have to make it every time you recite the ayah of sajda. Thank you, Umm Sana from the KSA. Assalamu alaikum. Shaheen from Japan.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Shaheen. Go ahead.
Yeah, Sheikh. Recently, a lot of Japanese people are converting to Islam. Alhamdulillah, I am also the one as well. Usually, these converted people learn from people here randomly. And there is a problem. All these madhahib such as Hanafi, Hanbali, Malik, Shafi is okay for us. Because all of these came from Sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But some groups are inviting us to their groups, such as, you know, some people believing in some scholar, special scholar, or a'imma, or special way of the dhikr and the dua can make them greater. Or there is a new prophet came after our beloved Khatam Nabiyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some people are saying that Al-Qur'an al-Kareem and the Hadith recorded by our great companions of him, radiallahu anhum, is changed. Like they are calling it Muharraf. Astaghfirullah. Calling themselves Muslim, a'udhu billah. So how can these Japanese new Muslim who doesn't have any knowledge to recognize them, how can we recognize this is the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah and this is the correct way? And the other one,
Shaheen,
how should I advise for these,
I got your question.
New Muslims?
Yeah, I got your question. Mashallah, in my last visit to Japan, whether Osaka or Tokyo or other cities, I have visited some Islamic centers. When I say Islamic center, it's not like in the States where we have big masajid and Islamic centers and a lot of activities. They're small and tiny. Japan is very expensive. So there are local imams, alhamdulillah, who belong to the mainstream ummah, Ahlu Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Stick to them. And I have attended and I have taught many new Muslims in their classes, alhamdulillah, in Tokyo particularly. So you have local imams, resort to them. And as for us, we'll be more than happy if you like to hold classes via Zoom or video conference for new Muslims and to accommodate their questions and answer their concerns. I would be more than happy to do that absolutely for free. We can organize that inshallah once every while, as long as it will help new Muslims to comprehend their deen. Obviously, this is what we can do for the time being. Inshallah, when the flights are resumed, we'd like to visit Japan again. There is no and there will not be any prophet after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and whoever claims so, he isn't Muslim. There are some sects who claim that they're Muslims, but they believe that they have a prophet after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They are definitely non-Muslims. So it's not like we can communicate with them, take few things and reject other things. No, absolutely not. It's like when somebody says that the Quran was recorded after the Prophet died and it may have some statements of the human beings. This person is a kafir. One word is not disputable. So we don't take anything from this person. If this person one day was a good person, then he started doubting the Quran and the word of Allah and says maybe some human beings have made some interference in it. So this person, everything he has said, and everything he is saying and will say in the future is totally rejected from this person. You do not compromise because this is a concept of belief. It's like La ilaha illallah, but one ilah. What is this exactly? So La ilaha illallah means none has a right to be worshipped but Allah, and it is inseparable from Muhammad Rasulullah. He's a seal of the prophethood. Assalamu alaikum. Sister Fatima from India.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi barakatuh. Laru Fatima, how are you? Welcome to the program.
Alhamdulillah, shukrullah, how are you?
I'm great, alhamdulillah. How was your parents?
I did lots of dua for you and Huda TV.
Beautiful, mashallah, and I'm sure Allah will answer your dua. Thank you so much, Peta. May Allah bless you and your family. Mashallah.
I have a request. Can you please tell me any tips or du'as for improving my knowledge to help me with memory and knowledge to help me for my hifz?
Yeah, mashallah. How many surah you know by heart? Yeah. I want to say, honey, habibi, little pita, how many surah you know by heart, Fatima?
30 surahs. I'm in the 30th juzu.
You finished juz amma, correct?
Yes.
Any other paras or just juz amma?
Surah Yasin.
Surah Yasin. MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. Okay, Fatima, Allah taught us in the Quran as He instructed His Prophet, peace be upon him, to invoke Him with this beautiful supplication, which is, وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدِنِي عِلْمًا. So, قُلْ is a command verb. Allah is telling him how to supplicate, to seek knowledge. Say, my Lord, increase me in knowledge. This is very satisfactory. So in your sujood, after you recite the Jood Sharif and before making taslim, before you conclude the prayer or after, رَبِّ زِدِنِي عِلْمًا. رَبِّ زِدِنِي عِلْمًا. Another beautiful dua, I'm going to say it in Arabic and I will give you its meaning. اللهم فقهني في الدين وعلمني التأويل. And where did he get this from? This is a beautiful dua and prayer that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم prayed for his cousin Abdullah ibn Abbas. He was a little older than you when he made this dua for him. And subhanAllah, he became the greatest scholar at all time and the greatest interpreter of the Quran. اللهم فقهه في الدين. Oh Allah, make him comprehend his deen. وَعَلِّمْهُ التَّأْوِيلِ. And teach him the interpretation of the ayat of the Quran. So now, you recite it for yourself. You say, اللهم فقهني في الدين. وعلمني التأويل. وقل رب زدني علما. Another beautiful dua. يا مفهم سليمان فهمني. يا معلم إبراهيم علمني. There is a beautiful dua. Also, in the sound hadith, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم taught us. It's a long dua, but it is worth discussing it right now. As I said, I'm not worried about finishing all the hadith all at once or wrapping up Riyadu Salihin and jumping into another book to cover. My purpose and my aim is to learn. So take it easy. Let it take whatever time it takes. Alhamdulillah wa shukrullah. The dua is even prescribed at the time of grief, sorrow, and whenever the person is kind of depressed. Allah the Almighty will deliver him out of the depression, will give him a relief, and make him feel better. Allahumma inni abiduka wa binu abidika. In your case, Fatima, you will say, Allahumma inni amatuka wa bintu amatika. Okay? Wa bintu abidika. Madin fiyya hukmuka. Adulun fiyya qadauka. So I would say the dua again from the scratch, as it is said in the first person, masculine. Allahumma inni abiduka wa binu abidika. Maadin fiyya hukmuka, adulun fiyya qadauka. Allahumma inni as'aluka bi kulli ismin huwa laka sammayta bihi nafsaka, aw anzaltahu fi kitabika, aw allamtahu ahadan min khalqika. أو استأثرت به في علم الغيب عندك أن تجعل القرآن العظيم ربيع قلبي ونور صدري وجلاء همي وحزني. اللهم ذكرني منه ما نسيت. And here is this reference which you asked for. So اللهم إني عبدك وابن عبدك ناصيتي بيدك ماض في حكمك عادل في قضاءك. And by the end you say, oh Allah, ذكرني منه ما نسيت وعلمني منه ما جهلت. So I hope you memorize this dua and I will be very happy to post it right now for you inshallah. And I'm sure you will memorize this supplication and you will invoke Allah with it. ذكرني منه ما نسيت. If I ever forget any of the Quranic verses, make me remember it. Remind me of it. علمني منه ما جهلت. Teach me what I do not know about it. بارك الله فيك يا فاطمة. Wallahi, little Fatima, you actually inspire us. Jazakillahu khayran, you and your parents. Assalamu alaikum. Ummu Mustafa from Bahrain, assalamu alaikum. Ummu Mustafa, assalamu alaikum. Muhammad from Bangladesh, please try again, sister Ummu Mustafa. Muhammad. أخي محمد، السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام شيخ.
Welcome to the program أخي. الحمد لله. I'm doing fine. And you?
الحمد لله شيخ.
Go ahead.
Sheikh, I have two questions today. The first is about the day of Arafah. You know, like Bangladesh, we have a day difference between the time of Saudi Arabia. So here people celebrate fast on the day of Arafah according to our 8th Zilhajj, which is the day in Saudi in 9th Zilhajj. So should we fast in the day of Arafah in Bangladesh in 9th Zilhajj according to our moon sighting, or 18th Zilhajj according to Saudi's?
Now, well, let me tell you this. If you follow your country who rely on the moon citation, and based on their examining the birth of the crescent, they said that, well, the beginning of the month of Dhul-Hijjah was a day later after Saudi or after the Middle East, you're not blameworthy. Fast with them. And in this case, you can fast the day before. So the 8th and the 9th, that's a win-win situation. The problem is if the day of Arafah happens to be Eid in your locality. And again, I advise, as long as you trust the administration in your locality that they do moon citation and they said, wallahi, it's not time yet. Or they say the 9th of Dhul-Hijjah is tomorrow, so you follow them and you're not blameworthy. Those who take the opinion and follow countries which fasted before them, like in Saudi, and they say the moon was confirmed in many countries. So why we be different? They are not blameworthy as well. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Umm Mustafa, assalamu alaikum from Bahrain.
Walaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Hello?
Yes, sister, go ahead.
Walaikum assalam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuhu. Brother, first I would say that I'm a very big fan of Huda TV and following it regularly since almost 10 years now, alhamdulillah. It has changed my life 360 degrees, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. And Huda TV is in my very, very special duas.
Allahu Akbar.
And Sheikh, a question was asked yesterday on a brother's behalf, which I guess was a little misunderstood, because that person really loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he's really disturbed, as he has great regard for Anas ibn Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, whose example was given. His only request is to get the reference of a hadith for less than three people offering Eid Salah at home. He couldn't find it from anywhere, so he just
but
wanted
sister,
the reference of a hadith.
Sister Mustafa, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, I can, brother.
I said you can even pray Eid by yourself. You can pray Eid individually. Jama'ah is not required for the Eid prayer. So you can pray by yourself. And if you want to pray Jama'ah, if I want to pray Fajr Jama'ah, can I pray myself and my wife? Yes or no?
Brother, I fully agree with this and okay. I am 100% with you. He just, his demand was only the reference of a hadith regarding this. And I told him, see, I have been following this and I have no questions. I am so clear, alhamdulillah, I'm 200% clear. And I would not even question this because I have been following this and I give the example of Huda TV everywhere. And if someone asks a question, when I give them the number, I feel as if it's my Eid day. I'm so happy that someone is connected to Huda TV. And someone asks me, ask a question, I say, please ask yourself, because I want them to be connected to Huda TV. That is my aim. Even my children, to look for something, just, you know, Google, ask Huda, and they find the answer there, alhamdulillah. So that makes me really, really happy, alhamdulillah. But his only question is that please give me a reference of a hadith so that he's satisfied. I don't know why he wants the reference of a hadith for
well,
less than three
a hadith.
People.
That's a hadith. What Anas ibn Malik used to do is an athar, is a reference. Why do you think? What do
but
you
brother,
think?
That's for yeah. But brother, that's you said that's with the family. That was his question. That
correct.
He used to offer with his family. So he says that's more than three people. This is what he was telling
well,
me. So
is,
I said,
this
I will.
This is an assumption. Yeah. This is an assumption. What is required for the Jumu'ah prayer, according to Imam Abu Hanifa, three people along with the Imam. According to Ibn Hazm, whatever Jama'ah is valid with, this is for the Jumu'ah. The Eid prayer is unlike Jumu'ah because Jumu'ah is a faridah, is mandatory. In the case of the Eid prayer is an emphatic sunnah. So one can pray by himself, and if you can pray by yourself, then you can add another one to you and that counts as Jama'ah. Is understood? This is not like the Jumu'ah prayer, Sister Umm Mustafa. I hope the answer is clear. So brothers and sisters, we did go over time 3-4 minutes ago, I believe, 3 minutes, 5 minutes ago. And by that, we come to the conclusion of today's edition of Gardens of the Pious, to be continued, inshallah, next time. Until then, I leave you all in the care of Allah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to him. He wanted humans to be the best and give his best religion to them.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price.
Rasulullah.